congratulations on the preseason. How's that make you feel about the announcement today?
I'm not sure that's a congratulatory thing, mm-hmm. you know, to be picked number one, to be honest with you. I think there are two things that come with that. One is, I hope, a great deal of respect for the program that you have. But the other part is there's some difficulty in that because you don't necessarily want your kids thinking that they're the best team in the league, that they need to earn that rather than be anointed with that. So I think that's what you worry about all the time. So it's, and all it is really is a prediction. It's not a result of a year well done. It's just a prediction, and there's going to be a lot of teams that are going to be after us, and I understand that. But I welcome the respect that is shown. I appreciate that very much.
And how about this first week of practice? Are you feeling good?
Yeah, I think we're doing okay. You know, I don't think we're doing great, but we're doing okay. It's a good group of guys, and what I find myself doing actually, I was usually a 2:45 and 3 hour per day guy at this time of year, but I think everybody kind of knows what it is we're doing, and we don't have that many bodies that we're putting out there, so we're able to go for 2:15 and 2:30, and it's up to me now to say, let's cut it off and let them go, which is not easy for me to do.
Understandably so. You grew up in Philadelphia, and you played all the style, and have coached at three schools in the city. What do you think, you know, is the best thing about Philly basketball?
Well, I am born and raised, so there's a prejudice already ingrained in me about Philadelphia college basketball. We think it's the best in the country. Mm-hmm. And really, I think what happened many, many years ago when the Big Five was created really enabled our sport to be seen in a little bit different light, that there was these great rivalries that were developed. And the best thing about it is the relationships that the coaches have with one another. I don't think there's any other city in America that does what we do in terms of the relationships between the coaches, whether it's at meetings or doing the charity functions we do or going out to speak to community service groups, those kinds of things. I just think we understand that many years ago somebody else put this concept together, and now we are presently the caretakers of it, and we need to do a really good job to promote and to let it continue.
Can you discuss the experiences teaching classes at Temple and how you balance that kind of with your coaching?
Well, I appreciate that. I did it for 7 semesters at Penn before I came to Temple, and now I'm doing this is my 4th semester, all in the fall, all like a Tuesday, Thursday kind of thing, an hour and 20 minutes each day. And to be quite honest with you, the fellow professor that I teach with really does all the work. I just kind of pontificate a few minutes of class. It's management theory and practice, and we label it from the locker room to the boardroom. I bring some guest speakers in, and I hope I give the practical approach of being a CEO of a very small corporation, because that's what I think that we are. We're all in sales. I'm the CEO. I have to manage down with my staff and with our personnel. I have to manage up with our athletic director, our president, our board of trustees, our the media, the alums, all those kinds of things take management. So we talk about that often within the classroom activities. And then there's a number of readings. They're all honor students, so they're far brighter than I. They challenge me greatly. It's really an engaging group of young people. And so it's a great deal of fun for me. And it's also a great time to get me out of the office for an hour and 20 minutes on Tuesday and Thursday and get a sense of what the kids on campus think about and really what our players are going through too on a daily basis as they go to class.
That's a great point. I mean, that's having that balance, you kind of having to balance it as well. I think that's really interesting. It's a great thing. about the, you know, a little bit more about this, the A-10 as a conference. If you could sum up the A-10 conference in one word, what would that word be?
Well, I mean, I think we always think the same thing each and every year. I think there's great balance within this league. I think there's really good coaches. There's really good programs. There's really good players. And really good history and tradition behind all of the programs. So I think the balance always is fantastic, and I think we're going to find that again this year, just as it's been each and every year that I've been in the league.
And what is your earliest memory of the Atlantic 10, whether it be, you know, as a fan or any sort of association? I use the example, when I was small, my cousin played field hockey for Richmond. So I remember going to the field hockey games, and mainly when they played UMass, because I'm from Massachusetts. But so that was like kind of my first connection with the conference. What do you have a moment like that you can think of?
You know, I think my first understanding of the Atlantic 10 was really the Eastern 8, which was the forerunner of the Atlantic 10. And I can remember Villanova playing Rhode Island. Maybe that is it. Is that correct, Doc, now that I think of it? I think that might have been a matchup, or George Washington, or Penn State, I think, was an original Eastern 8 member. But Villanova was absolutely in there. And that's my earliest recollection of where the Atlantic 10 was before it is what it is now, you know. So always, and the other part was I was a basketball coach at University of Pennsylvania for a lot of years, and the Atlantic 10 tournament was in the Palestra. And I used to love sitting there watching the games, and it was a great opportunity for the kids that were on our team to sit there and watch other teams play as well, not only in the games themselves, but also in the preparation that they had, and just how much pressure was on these young men to advance within their own Atlantic 10 tournament, then hopefully get to the NCAA tournament, because when I was at Penn, we had no postseason play. Mm-hmm. It was just whoever won the regular season was granted the opportunity to go to the NCAA tournament. So it was a pretty neat experience for our kids to go through. And the last part of it, I hope I shut up after this, is that there were a lot of the fans would make a day of it. You know, there'd be a couple of days of full, all day long playing basketball. And I had a lot of friends that would come down, pack a lunch, and they'd sit up in the stands, you know, and just watch all day long in basketball. So that's the kind of city Philadelphia is, that it would welcome an opportunity to host an Atlantic 10 tournament.
which school within the A-10 do you think is the toughest to play at?
You know, and just based off of last year, we went on the road twice last year and got ourselves beat up a little bit with at Charlotte and at Richmond. And we didn't have to go on the road to Xavier and to Dayton. And I can just go on and on now. Each and every year, every place is tough. And because I think the teams are good, the coaches are good, and again, I think the fans in each and every site are looking to have the home team win. So you hear a little bit of grief, and I think that's great stuff. I think it's what life is about as we go about our Atlantic 10 schedule.
And then quickly we'll transition into the A-10 Quick 10, if you will. Just a few quick hitter, you know, personal questions just to get a little bit of information about you. if you weren't a coach, what would your dream job be?
I'm not sure. Maybe I would be a caddy on the PGA Tour. That's what my dream job would be.
A nice little son.
Or a cab driver in New York City.
That takes a lot of skill. I've learned that quickly just from being here. I don't think I could ever do that. But
I always thought I wanted to be a school teacher, to be honest with you, and a guidance counselor. So I started out doing that before I was whisked away to be a college basketball coach. But I think there's a lot of great professions out there. But I think teaching is one of those consummate jobs that I think people can really be fulfilled with. And I think that's the biggest thing for me each and every day as you go home. Did you have a successful day? Did you help somebody do something that particular day? And I think in the teaching profession, you get some instant gratification. You get some understanding of whether or not you're doing a good job just by watching faces and body languages and those kind of things.
Mm-hmm. tell us something about you that you think would surprise people that know you.
It was interesting. I was in the newspaper the other day because I had mentioned something to one of our sports writers in Philadelphia about there was a big race, NASCAR race in the Charlotte Motor Speedway last Saturday. So people don't think that I'm a NASCAR fan, but I like it. I like all sports, and I'm a frustrated NASCAR driver, too. I would love to get in one of those cars and fool around.